Welcome to the CNBC TV 18 GST Town Hall. We are joined by the Revenue Secretary, Dr. Hasmukh Adia. He is in conversation here and will be taking questions from the CNBC TV 18 special panel of tax experts. They've been tracking the GST legislation with us over the last several months. Mr. Adia, thank you very much for joining us here on CNBC TV 18. So let me start by asking you about the timeline as far as the rollout is concerned. The Finance Minister said he's reasonably confident of being able to roll out the GST on the 1st of July. MPs, as well as state finance ministers, believe that in order for there to be an efficient rollover, perhaps it would be more prudent to push the date beyond July. What is your own assessment?
Well, so far in the discussions that took place in the GST Council, this is the date that we have frozen. If there are new factors which come to table, then maybe the GST Council may have to discuss and take a view about it. But as of now, from the government side, we are fully ready.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if the businesses are saying that they are not ready, then they should tell us so that we can.
I believe some businesses have already made representations seeking more time.
I haven't got any.
Okay.
I've been hearing about it in the news channels.
But nobody has come to you seeking more time.
Not yet.
Sir, what could be some of the other factors beyond industry saying that, look, we need more time to switch over? What could be the other factors that may weigh on the mind of the GST Council if indeed the date were to be pushed beyond the 1st of July?
I can't visualize any such other factor. But once we reach out to the trade and industry, and once they start finding out what is in for them, there would naturally be presser lobbies which will try to hold the process, you know.
Mm.
So, but then we would like to communicate with them properly. And that's why I'm saying that the biggest challenge in the next 3 months is going to be outreach program for the trade and industry.
Okay.
That's going to be our biggest challenge.
What is the current state of the migration to the GSTN, sir?
About 60% of those who are supposed to migrate have already migrated.
Okay.
The remaining are still to be covered.
Okay. So you've set up these expert groups to look into these specific concerns raised by specific industries, textiles, gems and jewelry, oil and gas, and so on and so forth. How is that feedback now going to be incorporated into the rules as part of the GST?
Well, rules and laws are almost finalized now. What we can do is that we want to prepare a sectoral paper on each one of them. So these working groups are supposed to be engaged with the industry people if they want to, because earlier also we had done the similar exercise.
Mm.
We had heard a lot of these industry groups. So they have all the information, they have all the presentations made by them. They know about the worries of the sector. Based on all this, how to tackle that sector and what are the nuances of this sector coming into GST. So a kind of a sectoral paper will be prepared by them, a guidance note, which will help the industry in coping up with it.
But how will you incorporate that into the rules? Because you expect to finalize the rules at the meeting of the GST Council tomorrow.
It may not require any major change in the rules itself.
Okay.
It's only a question of, you know, telling them how to handle that particular sector.
So there's enough flexibility to take their concerns on board, because the expert groups are expected to submit their recommendations only around the 10th of April, I believe.
Yes, yes.
Okay. Before I get our experts to ask you questions, sir, because they have several of them, let me very quickly ask you a question as far as the rate fitment exercise is concerned. And that process, I am given to understand, will happen starting next month. Do you believe that we will get clarity on rates only closer to the 1st of July, or will it be significantly ahead of that?
I think 95% of the clarity is already there. Only 5% cases you will have to be given clarity.
Okay.
We already said that the rate is known to you.
Hmm.
Why
so that means it's status quo.
Are you saying
it's status quo as far as rates are concerned?
No. Yes, that's what we are saying. We have been saying always that the tax incidence which is presently on a commodity or a service, the rate that we are going to fix will be closer to that.
Okay. So let's take an example, because these are the questions that we've been getting from our viewers. Let's take the example of a small car. The current incidence is about 28% or so as far as a small car is concerned. So you're saying it will remain at 28%. On luxury cars, including the CESS, there may in fact be a possibility that the rate would come down?
come down? Why should it come down?
Because
whatever is the existing incidence, we would like to maintain that.
So you would like to maintain that. If it's about 40-odd% or a little more than 40% currently, as far as luxury cars are concerned, the rate of incidence will remain the same.
Yes, almost.
So status quo as far as rates are concerned.
That's what. We don't want to change everything in one go, because right now our focus is on transiting from one form of taxation system to another form of taxation system. Rates are something which are more or less supposed to be the same.
Okay. All right. Rates are supposed to be the same. Let's bring in our questions now. And we've got Prateek Jain joining us. Prateek, here's the Revenue Secretary. And go ahead with your first question.
Yes. So, sir, my first question is on the working group that has been constituted last Friday. And I must, applaud the effort of the government in this regard. Industry is very happy about that. But we noticed that on the manufacturing side, FMCG or consumer durables, that kind of a sector is not covered. And there are lots and lots of issues that the FMCG sector is facing, under GST on the procedure side, like transition stock and several others. So, sir, is it possible to expand the ambit of the working group to constitute a working group for FMCG sector as well?
Well, if the need be, we can always expand the number of groups. But I don't think FMCG requires special treatment because there is nothing that, that is odd about that sector which we need to address. For example, why we are taking petroleum and gas sector is because it is not in the GST, but still some of their inputs will be, having the burden of GST. So those are the reasons why we are constituting these working groups. If FMCG has got some kind of a worries about transition rules, the transition rules will be coming tomorrow. So they should be looking at the transition rules first and that will take care of that.
Okay, so at this point in time, you don't believe that there needs to be any specific group to look into the concerns of the FMCG sector. Since we were talking about special treatment, sir, if I could ask you about exemptions, because that is one big area of concern. In our conversations with state finance ministers, the view that we've got is that as far as the state exemptions are concerned, state governments will have to figure out a way of being able to continue with that. What about the central exemptions, sir?
In the first or second meeting of GST Council itself, we had settled this case. We have told the states, and the central government also abides by it, that there will be no exemption possible under the GST regime.
Hmm.
If there is any incentive which has been promised to any industry by the central or the state government, they may decide whether to grandfather them or not.
Hmm.
And if they decide to grandfather, they have to do so by way of reimbursement rather than exemption route.
Hmm.
As far as central government is concerned, we have given some incentives to some of the hill states in the northeast and the Jammu and Kashmir. And FM had in that meeting itself declared that we will be also honoring them, grandfathering them to the extent of 58% of CGST.
Hmm.
Why? Because we are only giving them excise duty concession, we are not giving any VAT concession to them. Out of excise, earlier we used to straight away exempt them. Now the tax will first come to the Government of India kitty. And if it comes in the kitty of Government of India will have to give 42% to states.
Hmm.
So whatever remains with us, we will give it back to them in a reimbursement route.
Okay.
So that is what we already decided. So there is no uncertainty about it.
And that, very clearly, wherever the commitments have been made, the commitments will be honoured both by the centre as well as the states.
States only have to decide for themselves.
The mechanism, exactly.
No, mechanism or whether to grandfather or not also.
Okay.
But what is for them.
But what has been the discussion at the level of the GST Council of the states?
States will decide individually. We have no idea what is the decision each state is going to take. But the general discussion and decision in the GST Council is that each of the state will decide whether to grandfather or not. And if they decide to grandfather, it will be only through reimbursement route, not through exemption route. In the GST tax system, there is no scope for exempting anybody because the input tax credit chain is broken if we exempt.
Hmm. But do you see that this could be a cause of concern, especially as far as people who've made long-term big-ticket investments, if a state were to choose not to honour the commitment?
Well, it is for these groups of people who are going to be affected to start worrying about it. They should approach the state government. But in spite of that, if the state governments decide, they are well within their rights. There are case laws which say that it's not necessary to grandfather under another law, another tax law,
And your smile says it all, Mr. Adia. But let me go across now to our other guests. We've also got Sachin Menon with us. Sachin, go ahead. Your question for the Revenue Secretary.
Well, sir, this is a very positive outreach to the consultant group. I have a question about the service definition. It said the service means that includes any activity relating to use of money. So, does this mean that the interest is also becoming a taxable service? Because there is no specific exclusion for interest anywhere in the Act.
Specific exclusion interest
is not provided for the interest.
Yeah, interest, no? You are saying?
Yeah, the service definition.
Yeah. No, please understand, Sachin, that, yeah, Sachin, please understand, we are going to almost inherit the entire service tax regime into GST. I mean, whatever may be the definition, but to begin with, if interest is exempt under the service tax regime, it will remain so in the GST regime, right? So, whatever is the present dispensation of interest in the service tax regime, that we plan to inherit in GST regime also. We don't want to upset it, you know. Right?
Sachin, does that address your concern?
Yeah, definitely that is our concern. Now, hopefully some exception will come later.
Let me also bring in Harishankar Subramaniam of... Let me bring in Harishankar Subramaniam of EY into the conversation. Hari, your question to the Revenue Secretary.
Sir, at the outset, would like to congratulate the government on the successful passage of the 4 GST bills in the Lok Sabha yesterday, and the countdown has finally begun. Sir, my question is, you know, in the model law that came out in November, you had gracefully agreed to provide a credit mechanism for capital goods like telecom towers and pipelines, and the period was over a period of 3 years. So it was a good gesture to the industry, and the industry was obviously some may have had a point of view on whether it should be 3 years or 2 years, but that was what was given. And I think it was a progressive movement, considering GST is a tax reform which basically removes the cascading, you know. But in the new law which is being debated in the parliament, or rather passed in the Lok Sabha, this has gone missing, you know. Was there a reason for doing this, Mr. Adia?
Well, there was a lot of two-hour discussion on this topic, you know, in the GST Council, I remember. And there were very strong views on this. And ultimately, the decision which emerged was what is there in the law today. You know, within the plants, it is easy to identify the pipelines and things which are attached to the plant. Mm. But outside the plant, if you start giving any kind of a... input tax credit for anything which is attached to the land, you know, there will be many other contentious items which will come. So that's why when the definition of plant and machinery was discussed, we specifically included it only if it is within the plant and not outside. So, I mean, a telecom tower is one, but there could be, say, for example, railway tracks. Now, railway tracks also, then there are other things also. Mm. So, a lot of such items will come up, you know, which are attached to the land, but still they are really not part of plant and machinery. So, after a lot of discussion, this is what is the final discussion and unanimous decision, you know.
This business of single registration versus multiple registrations, and states at this point in time are not in favor of a centralized registration, which is the big concern of sectors like the banking and financial services space. Is there a window, is there a room within which you can ensure that this concern will be addressed? The finance minister seemed to suggest that there is clause 148 that perhaps can be exercised in some form or fashion. What could be the way out if states don't necessarily still come on board?
Well, single registration is something which the states have outrightly rejected. That's something which is not going to become a reality. But their worry is not so much registration, their worry is audits done by different states, in which different states try to pull them in different direction. Because every intra-company supply is also going to be accounted for. And you have to create an invoice, you have to do valuation of it, and you have to provide for it when you are doing intra-company interstate supply. Intra-company but interstate supply. Now, these are the things which if one state is challenging in a different way, the other state is challenging in a different way, and if the audits go in different ways, then what happens? They are torn apart. So these are the concerns which can be taken care of under 148. We will try to discuss in the meeting of GST Council, and we'll try and see if we could have some sort of a consolidated audit provision for them, subject to GST Council approving.
So this is going to be something that the centre will try and push?
We will try and discuss it.
Since we're speaking of disputes, and before I get to the tax experts, I remember Rohan Shah yesterday on our panel raised this issue of what happens if there is a dispute between a state and a state. So there's no issue between a company or, you know, one company and its arm in a different state. But what if there is an issue between two states and the company gets caught between the two warring states?
That's
what happens then?
The appeal provisions provide that in such cases where there is a place of supply issue involved, then only the central government will do the audit.
Okay.
They will only adjudicate. Suppose if the dispute relates to place of supply.
Okay.
In the audit. Then it will be adjudicated only by central government.
By the central government.